House calls.
Purposely, like, so
they, you know, if they're at a meeting or something, it's happened before. People have been appointed and then sworn in on the spot. I've seen it.
Neither one of them did.
Have Bibles.
Cross the board.
Not good. So that means we only have officially three board members? Got the lovers, got the lovers. Right.
I'm here.
Hello.
Aaron.
Yep. Yep. This can't be a legal meeting. No, there isn't. They can have a workshop, but they can't have a formal meeting.
About all the positions we have to fill this year, because we have
resources, the five of us, I'm hoping there. I'm going to speak slowly, because first of all, Aaron will be on the way, and the town clerk will be coming at 7 to swear in our team members, so we won't take any official action until after.
Yay!
After that time, sorry. And apparently that's the district chair who's, all right, we do have an official quorum now, so we can't take any official action if we don't train.
No stress, it's stress.
Got to slow the water down here and get up my bottle of water while Aaron's getting this. Anyway, we have a number of positions, as we know, and we have to figure out, I think, probably the best way to pool our resources to see who can best do what things. First of all, I'd like to congratulate Tom and Emily for running again and winning, and Brent Rhodes gave a pretty good showing also, so.
I want to thank all the support. all one.
So in a way, it almost seems like a lot of work to talk about some of this stuff, but I think we should do it anyway just to get a sense. So we have a chair and a vice chair, and whether we continue to call them chair and vice chair or we call them co-chairs, we can think about that. And I'll quickly run down sort of the time elements involved in that. So it's these meetings, preparing for these meetings. It's meeting the week before with the superintendent to set the agenda. It is also, the chair is also part of the executive team of the SAU board. So, this is very good. So now we're going to have a little pause. Thank you so much.
Oh, we don't have a line out the door.
Do you guys want to be on camera for this, or do you want to just step over?
We've got to get it done.
All right. Okay, so thank you so much. They're
going to
step over
to the
corner.
Oh, sure, sure. Okay, yeah, step over there, or if you step over here.
Okay, so I decided not to have it. I'm going to.
Okay.
It's not usually a public swearing in for them, so thank you so much.
Sorry. Oh, we are going to be on camera.
Oh, sorry.
Make sure we get this for posterity.
Swearing on wheels.
Yeah, that's me. Okay, Emily, there's yours. These I just need you guys to fill out, but I'll swear you in and then we'll get them filled out.
I'm actually doing
3 years, huh?
Okay, kids. That's it. Raise your right hands. So when I say I, obviously you state your name and you also state your position. So I do solemnly swear that I will bear faith and true allegiance to the United States of America and the state of New Hampshire, will support the Constitution thereof, so help me God. It's like we're getting married.
I was like, I'm not sure
which
one I said.
I do that. Do solemnly and sincerely swear and affirm that I will faithfully and impartially discharge and perform all duties incumbent upon me as school board member, according to the best of my abilities, agreeable to the rules and regulations of the Constitution and laws of the state of New Hampshire, so help me God. See, it's like getting married.
It is.
Yeah, I do.
Congratulations.
It's official. No, I left the entry with a mask, but I'll get one. I did Corey, but I guess I got to do him again.
Can you do all this?
Yeah.
Okay.
I can't wait for that day.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, I mean, if he's not there Saturday.
Yeah. Congratulations. Yes, congratulations.
Yeah. I just can't do the swearing in Saturday because I'm being sworn in.
Oh, so is the judge going to swear in Saturday or something?
We have an attorney.
Yeah.
Okay, very good.
Okay, thank you.
Right.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Congratulations, Tom.
Watch the cooler. Thank you.
Yeah.
Sometimes a lot happens. This last year has been a prime example of that. Sometimes not a lot happens on this board. It is also, so that's, so sometimes there's a lot of, there, I'm trying to think of other things that we share. What's it for chair duties? Our vice chair fills in when the chair is not.
Monitors the health.
Arguing away. One of the things that, and I'm thinking we can do away with the secretary position. I don't think, I think Emily's held it as a no.
Yeah.
And we don't know what the secretary does, right? Because we have a secretary that takes our name. So I think we can do away with that.
It's fair. I have an agreement.
This year we are also the SAU board chair. So, and again, sometimes there's a lot going on at the SAU level. This last year it is one of those years that lots been going on. Some years there's very little that you have to deal with except chair three or four meetings. Tom held it last. Do you want to give any more for us? Do you want to give any more definition?
No, it's just that there's stuff that comes up, you know, at that level, and you know, it's basically rounding everybody up, the executive team. And just, you know, especially when we had stuff like the superintendent search, that was a little more aggressive because we have to get the search committee ready and the questions, and that required meetings. So, I mean, it's not as often as the regular board, but it can be more involved, and there can be like lots of little meetings surrounding one big one, and then they'd be nothing for months. So that's pretty much it.
And there are things that the SAU board chair knows about that even the chairs of the other boards don't know about because.
And they're a conduit between the SAU press, act as the spokesperson.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's pretty much it.
The other things that we definitely have to do are the budget committee rep. The budget committee will probably be in April, and we should have a rep and an alternate, I think, just to be safe. That, there are four quarterly meetings, and then pretty much all of November and December, once a week. Pretty much that. And the Saturday hearings in April. So, and there will be an extra deliberative session that should be attended to now that we are no longer a town meeting town starting next year.
I think you would admit too that there is a lot of time, especially in the summer, that's the one thing. It's tough around the holidays. It's tougher in December.
Yeah.
Because everything is there. It also depends on the efficiency of the board. If there are a lot of people on there that just get things done, moves right along. Because there were times they had meetings that were well deep into the night.
Budget committee itself.
Yep. Yeah. So that hasn't happened recently.
No, it hasn't. So I'm just throwing everything out. Negotiations. Negotiations usually start in August-ish. August, September. I guess September by the time we get our first meeting. And they usually go, it all depends, but there's probably four or five meetings. This year it went to mediation. Anyway, it went to an extra step this year. So that can be a whole day when that happens, but hopefully that will not happen anytime soon. So so two people to that, two people on the board are moving to that. And this last year we had two and an alternate. And we almost had to call in an alternate once, as I recall. So just letting people know what everything that's out there. I like the community connections team is good as a subcommittee. Our community connections are working well. But the other new thing we have this year that we'll be talking about later on is a search for a principal for RGS too. And there'll be at least one, maybe two board members involved in some of that. So that's sort of the overview. And that's going to start pretty soon. So. So, and I hope people have given some thought as to what their commitment can be and some of the things they can do as we think about. So, the first thing, oh, Louis, vice chair? Do we want to do co-chairs? What do we want to do for that? By, what would the difference be? I'm even asking myself, what would the difference be if we did it that way?
I think you need one person. I think there needs to, this is, it's difficult because you have people with different schedules. So you don't want to, you know, what may work for one may not work for the other. So I don't know. I would think it would be more difficult to have two chairs.
Well, I think you've done a super job. I prefer you continue, but I realize that you've taken on a lot. So, you know, in going through all those tasks, I think we could remove you some of the other committees and things so that you wouldn't have to do as much of all that. And if you like the idea of a co-chair or maybe you still be the lead, but someone will win you perhaps more.
Delegate more to a vice chair or share the responsibility more.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I'm not sure as far as dividing up the work of the chair, how easy that is. Mm-hmm. If you know, even regardless whether it's co-chair or chair and vice, how easy it is to kind of divide out some of that work because it kind of all feeds into the same. So I don't really, you know, I feel like that's a hard thing to do.
Do you want to step in on that?
I would just say, I think, you know, kind of to Tom's point, you know, thinking about the role that, and the, you know, the communication that you and I have had, Judy, I think it would be cleaner, if you will, if it was one person. Mm-hmm. You know, then, as you know, it's a relationship that you have to cultivate. And so, as over the last few months, you know, we've kind of gotten to know each other a bit, and, you know, so I understand more, and I'm sure this will be what Bob would say as well, that, you know, you're looking at, you know, again, cultivating a relationship and that communication, how does that best work? Some people have different styles, and then, you know, some people prefer email, we go back and forth, or some people prefer the book, you know. So I think, you know, I think it would be easier, I think, for the superintendent if it was one point person. That said, maybe there are some specific things that could be divvied out to the, so that the vice chair is more than just somebody that runs the meeting if you're not able to be there. So,
yeah. How do you feel?
No, so I wanted to open it up to conversation, yeah. And I wanted to give everybody an idea of what the overview is for all the work that we have to do as a board. I think I agree that one person is a point person, and maybe using this year, this is the last year of my term, using this year to have the vice chair be much more, you know, maybe keep the vice chair more informed than even than I try to inform the board. Yes, we keep going. Well, I'm sorry. I'm saying aye. You see, we have not yet had.
Oh, I think
sorry.
I threw it out there, but I mean, I didn't actually. I mean, were any of you looking to put your name in the?
Yeah,
this time.
Okay. Yeah, that's
good. Judy, as our chair, once again.
Second. Is there a second? Yeah,
okay,
second.
All
in favor?
Aye. Those opposed?
So my opposition. Thank you very much. I appreciate the faith you put in me, and I really would like to use the time this year to do whatever I can to help everybody else and keep the board going. It's you know, it, anyway. All right, so I guess I now take over the meeting. So, nominations for vice chair. No one maybe drawing into a little bit more.
Anyone who's interested?
Yeah.
Let's start there.
Negotiations again this year.
We haven't so on.
I know.
Yep, okay.
And the alternate to the budget committee was good.
The alternate.
I was actually kind of thinking of the SAU.
Well, that's gonna be chosen from anybody here except for one, except for the chair.
Now, yeah, we're not gonna nominate that tonight. That will be done at the next SAU board meeting. I mean, at the May SAU board meeting, but I just want it to be kept on people's mind.
Well, that's right.
Someone other than the chair of this board.
Divvying up work, you know.
Yes.
About that.
Yes, as we're thinking about all the work.
Yeah.
I mean, so, yeah.
Let's talk me some, so I mean.
I could be too.
I'd like to nominate Emily as our vice chair.
Well, so here's the thing.
Here's the thing, everybody.
I need to say it because I know how much work it is in a very busy time for me, but I would be willing to do budget or vice chair if, depending upon what other people's interests are.
Well, let me make clear. I do not wish to sit on the negotiation team this year. So I know. I mean, I would like to. I'm very pleased with the way this year went, but I'm so
willing to do that.
Me too. And you too, right?
Yep. And you know, so we're just talking now. We're not taking any nomination checks yet. And Emily has just thought about the budget.
I would step up and say vice chair if you do budget. So what are the commitments?
Looks like the key stuff is getting to be an alternate on the budget, which I am also having. Subcommittee, and I believe the chair can locate So be it. All right, I think that covers everything we really have to do. Later on, we'll talk about our attendance at the Kansas School Board Association annual meeting and let's see if anyone can go, and if so, all right, officers, thank you very much. Let's move forward. Any comments by visitors? We will now open it up to comments by visitors. Anyone? I would like to thank everyone on this board, some folks sitting in the audience, some folks in the town who worked so hard on election materials, educating the voters. Because there was no school, Becky Wright and Lindsay Cation spent a great deal of that wicked day outside. And it was wonderful to see, as we all know, Mrs. Wright, that every single child has gone to school here for the last over 20 years, pretty much, since kindergarten, knows Mrs. Wright. And really, so there were teenagers and older people coming up and saying, oh, my, Mrs. Wright, good to see you. Talking to them, so it's just really nice to have them there. They could share more detail on some of the like gardening and stuff for those. It was just really great to have them there, and I think it made a difference to have them there. So thanks to the union, thanks to all the workers that helped everyone on every single school initiative passed. So felt good. It's been a long time. So thank you all for that. So comments by visitors. None, move forward. Consent calendar contains February 8th minutes and March enrollment. Motion to accept consent calendar or remove it from this motion.
Second.
Determine all of those from our
So the state, we feed information to the state, and the state comes back and says, here's the number of students who qualify. They decide who qualifies.
No, that's determined, we determine.
Some students are predetermined.
There's two ways.
Right.
One is a direct start, which gets given to us from the state, and that's for students that have food stamps and TANF numbers and things like that. So that gets automatically uploaded every month. There's another way, a paper form, which parents can fill out themselves to say, this is my income, and there's income guidelines to tell you whether or not they qualify. That gets inputted by Gwen in our office into Mealtime, and Mealtime calculates whether or not they meet that threshold for income.
Thank you, and I think if I'm hearing you correctly, Laura, the importance of this is that some of the aid from the state would be reduced. This is a two-thirds reduction. So
this is a one-year.
It's a one-year drop. Given, I know, it's significant, so I mean, granted, it's a small population, but still, you know.
Do numbers tend to stay fairly consistent? I mean, they may fluctuate somewhat, but you don't typically see that kind of fluctuation. So that's why we just want to make sure that, you know, the numbers that have been mistaken are truly accurate numbers, and, you know, again, some more follow on that.
It sounds like there's another question.
Oh, I was just asking what funds it's tied to, type 1.
Our adequacy money too.
Yeah, adequacy money is also tied into that as well. It's part of that formula. So it does have some far-reaching implications. So again, we want to make sure that, you know, this is accurate, because this is just not what we expect to see. So more to find, for sure. So those are the two things that I wanted to share. Yes. Students who are
there's a lot going on. How does it feel to be a senior and seeing all these things happening? A lot of it doesn't affect you anymore, so.
Yeah, it's a bit of a relief.
And how old do you have to be to give blood?
I believe 16 is the oldest son, but you can be younger as much as a parent's.
So 16 without a parent's? Wow, I didn't realize that. I wrote it down to ask. Thank you, Noah. Anyone else have questions for Noah? And now the Summersworth rep, Bailey. And of course, I mean, we know that all of your reports now are going to start being produced 2 weeks. That will be the last Summersworth reports we'll be receiving.
This is my last year.
And it's your last year, and the last time we'll have a Summersworth report at all. So, thank you.
I'll try to make you guys proud. So, our student council is planning various fundraisers for an upcoming New York trip towards the middle of April. We're planning on going to Harlem to visit a daycare and just kind of do our efforts there and just involve ourselves with the community there. We're also working on our honor book, which helps us maintain our honor council status with this whole, like, New Hampshire league of student councils. And we've also been splitting into various groups to just tackle different projects and goals we have. Our National Honor Society chapter is planning a teacher luncheon for next Friday, March 23rd. We always do this for teachers on their teacher workshop days. We're also volunteering at UNHS in 2 weeks, and we're working on doing something with PEAS readers. We've been trying to do this for a while, but it's hard to nail down dates, so we're planning on April 7th. And then we're planning a coffee shop fundraiser type thing. So we're working on the logistics of that and what that would look like. That is one of the goals for the near future. Our classes are all doing busy things. So our freshman class has a March Madness fundraiser basketball game. It's seniors versus staff members. That's tomorrow in the high school gym at 6 o'clock. I'm coaching the team, so I have nothing about basketball. It's totally fine. Our sophomore class is playing karaoke night on March 22nd in our Mulligan's Grill. The junior class has begun selling tickets for prom, which is crazy. Their prom is May 19th. And then the senior class is finalizing details for project graduation and senior banquet. We have quite a few things to celebrate in the building. So this past weekend, our culinary team, there's like 5 or 6 students. They took third place in the competition at UNH. They've been working so hard. It was really awesome to see them succeed. And the boys varsity basketball team won the championship for the NHAA Division III league. they beat Campbell. That's the coach, yeah. But it was a really, really awesome experience. I went to the semifinals and the championship game. We're both last weekend. It was an awesome turnout. We actually had a parade like after the game, and after the boys got back, we had an escort by the police to the school. It was insane. The amount of community and just positivity around the event and supporting these boys was really just outstanding. As for some not so fun things, the SATs are coming up next week. The juniors can take the SATs on that day. The other classes are kind of busy with their own respective activities. So I believe the freshman class is going on a field trip. The sophomore class is taking the PSATs, and then the senior class is doing anything related to their future. So new scholarships. Working, if you're going to interview, touring school, shadowing, all that fun stuff. As far as sports go, spring sports are starting soon as well. There's actually a sports meeting tonight. We have our graduation date. It was officially released today, so we'll be graduating on June 15th.
June 15th?
June 15th.
Thank you. How is it for you as a senior watching all these things?
It's crazy. We started signing up for classes this week too, so it's crazy to not like be filling out those forms. And
yeah, you just got to say, oh,
yeah,
me.
Yeah, I didn't know what to do. What? But yeah, it's great.
Well, all right. Well, we appreciate it. We're finishing out the year with two of you, and it'll be really good. And we don't know if it's going to come in because you're both graduating. Right? So far, you're both graduating. Okay, sure. We're both planning on it. All right. Thank you very much for your report. As usual, you're welcome to stay, but we know you're busy and have things to do, so you're also free to leave if you choose. Thank you. Now we'll hop into our principal's report. part is about the grant. We do want it to fall in this fiscal year. We want it to fall in this fiscal year. And I've done the math, and at the very end, should we get it, we'll get about $63,500 if they agree to cover everything. We put it, and thank you, Kate and Lori, for working on that grant. Which means, and it would cost us about $12,700 to get that amount of work done. And that's just fabulous. I mean, here's hoping, fingers crossed, we can get that. That would really help a lot. So any other questions on like that kind of thing that you guys can do? Kate, is there anything you want to add to that? Is there anything else now that you'd like to add? I know there are some things we're going to be discussing in non-public later on, and I would like you to stay for that as well. We discussed later on that we're mentioning that we're discussing. Are there other things that you'd like to add to?
No, just the fourth bullet down where I sort of talk about literacy as a whole and some of what Lori had mentioned. The team had intended to meet one of the snow days, it intended to meet the second snow day. We were going to try and meet today. We had four people out sick that were supposed to be on that team. So we will do our best to meet next week. So when we come in April, we have a very fleshed out proposal about some of the ways to remedy and support literacy instruction, intervention, I should say, at GS. It's just what we wanted to gather for.
Any questions for Kate at this point? We will be doing non-public on bullet 3 because we don't want to discuss specifics about safety in public. And also on bullet 4 we're doing some discussion. And bullet 5? No, bullet 5 we'll be discussing later on in the agenda. Okay. Thank you, Kate. We were sent the schedule of our board meetings for next year. We were sent the schedule of our board meetings for next year. They look good. They're what they are. It's the February and April ones. It's the February and April ones that need to be. March one has to be moved, right? 14th can't possibly be the. Did we look at it? When is the election next year? I think we did look at it. You're right.
Yeah. It's always good to double check, but I think we found it that day.
I think you're right.
Right.
I'm sorry, I'm just going to check one more time.
All right. Good to check.
It is the second Thursday, which is as late as it can possibly be, as it's early as it can possibly be, and the 12th will be election day next year, so you're right. Great, an earlier election day. Let's see what kind of nor'easter we can get next year. So I don't, do we have to accept these? I mean, or is this just informational?
Okay. It's more informational. I don't think so. You need to take a vote or anything, but I think it's just to confirm and then we can get this out.
Any questions on that? Any discussion on that? Given the next item on the agenda, I had asked to be added. We had the SAU board had made a statement about supporting students' rights, their First Amendment rights. Peaceful protest, and I just wanted to make just bring it up in our board meeting. We were all there, most of us were there, and we supported that. And this school didn't have school, and it sounds like Marjorie did some stuff, and I'm assuming some stuff happened at summer's work today. Yeah. And there's been a lot of good information. Available for people, and now there's an excellent article, and I don't think it was Foster's, I think it was the New York Times, about how, it might have been Foster's, just how this can be a very educational time for students who to be used, and that their First Amendment rights do not stop at the door of the school. Very clearly do not. Anyway, so, would anyone like to make any Have any discussion on that or talk about that at all? And we're, because we're a grade school, we're not as affected. I'm assuming some of the high schools may have students going down to the march in Washington. I don't know. We'll probably find out from local papers or some of you may know people have, because you have students there. All right, so that was just so that we could bring that up. Along with that, I believe there is legislation going through in the New Hampshire legislation. I don't get to read all of the school board legal updates, but they are talking about, and we see it on the national level, about guns in schools. As an individual, I am adamantly opposed to having any guns in schools. All of the news that we see now of the teachers who are carrying guns, they have injured students by mistake already. I mean, it's just amazing. I don't know what's going to happen with the New Hampshire legislation, but I don't know what we can do as a school board. But those are things we will be looking into, obviously, as we go forward, what we can do and how we can keep our schools as safe as possible.
Because I think there's a few things that are happening. There's, around school safety and those kinds of things. But there's also legislation, I believe it's SB 357, which is going to allow boards, if it passes, to make decisions about whether you or not you can carry in schools. Now, it seems, in some respects, counterintuitive that folks would be able to bring a gun into school. But that can happen. So the legislation is to allow a board to say, yes, that's okay, or no, that's not okay. So that's some of the legislation that's moving through right now. So we'll see where that all ends up. But it dovetails into that safety, so it's a very layered discussion, I guess, at this point.
It is. And I believe we have a policy right now that says we are a no firearm zone. I believe we do. And I forgot to look that up before I came.
So currently there are schools that teachers allowed to, like, I guess the governing laws of the
it's state not, we don't typically think about it as with teachers, but I think like the general public
right.
could come in, if they were,
if you can see, yeah,
yeah, if they had a care, a permit to carry, that right. that would be okay. And so I think that's really where the legislation kind of was starting. But I think with everything that happened in Florida, and then with all the various threats and problems, communities around the nation have experienced. I think for New Hampshire, they're like, oh, so what are we going to do around teachers? I've had some conversations with teachers, and some people don't want anything to do with it. Some are like, well, I'm comfortable with a firearm. So I think it's more to follow as we move forward. But it's tough because how do you try to find solutions or preventions or interventions for what's been happening? So.
We will have many discussions, I think, as this goes on. The American Medical Association 20 years ago did a survey and a study, and they found that with homes that had guns in them, there were more people were injured than lives were saved, or property was saved. They found more people were injured, and they used to ask a question, is there a gun in your home? During medical examinations. They no longer do that because of the pushback they got from that, but they stand by their survey of 20 years ago. So we'll have interesting discussions as this goes on. Thank you. Mm-hmm. All right, so the next item here was put on sort of, it's called calendar last day of school. So we all know that we have had our eighth snow day yesterday. And that pushes our school, end of school, into the last week in June. It actually pushes us into the second day in the last week of June. I think there are some things as all of us know, either as teachers, as parents, as anything else, the later you go into June, the less interested the kids are about learning anything. So the more we can sort of keep those kids focused earlier, the better it will be. And I believe we have a suggestion of a way to keep it from bleeding over quite so far. Is that
sure. I think probably Kate would be best to speak to this, because these were different scenarios that she's looked at.
Yeah. This was our eighth, and it may not be the last one.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I would say it's okay to have out her scenarios that, we are going to, I had a conversation with our new superintendent, Dr. Podomsky, today, and, I talked with him about, what are some of our other options, and so I think there may be some appetite at the state level for waivers. So, not to complicate, the conversation, but, that's something that, we will further explore as well, because, like you said, we're not done with, we may not be done, I should say it that way.
Don't even say it.
Wow, I've had more, and it's only March, so we'll see. I'll let Kate present.
I'm going to present to you guys four different options. I want to be clear, because I'm not suggesting these are the answer, these are just four possible options to consider. And then when we finish going the options, I'll talk about a few of the considerations that have kind of fed into this and continue to be part of the conversation. So the top part, eight snow days. So this has been, I've been doing this for weeks, by the way, so you'll see it's updated as of today. Which would put us on June 26th. Our biggest concern here at RGS is that pretty much after June 1st, it's lost instructional time for us regardless. Particularly on years when we go to Nature's Classroom. So this year is a Nature's Classroom year where our fifth and sixth graders go away for a week. When they return, it is really hard to rope them back in. As parents of pets and fifth and sixth graders, you know what I'm talking about. And when your oldest students are struggling to be focused and be attentive, you know that kind of leads into the rest of the building. So as teachers, as the educators in the building, our biggest factor for us was how do we maximize learning time between now and whatever happens to be the last day of school. The way I broke this down is a suggestion to swap. We have three teacher workshop days that remain. We have one next week, we have one April 2nd, we have one May 25th. I'm suggesting we swap those for student days and do teacher workshop days at the end of the year. That is not ideal for teachers. I want to be clear. That's why we space them out over the year, because we like the idea of learning and practicing and then coming back. But that is second to our students' optimal learning time. So that's sort of the conversation as a staff. Is it sacrifice for us of having to do learning together at the end is more important if our students then get condensed learning that's not lost. So that was sort of the motivating factor for that. If we do the 3 days and then make June 15th a full day, which would equal four full days, we would then need to come up with 4 days of time. So you'll notice that 6.2 hours is a day times four. In this scenario, we're looking to make up 24.8 hours. So option one looks at adding 30 minutes a day for 50 days, which equals 25 hours. That would start on March 30th and go till June 15th, which would then be our last student day. Teachers, I'm suggesting, would come back on the 18th and the 19th for two teacher workshop days and do what we did last year, which was 1 day for teachers to do with flexibility. So some people staying Wednesday afternoon for 4 hours and then coming the following week, depending on some of our book studies that are going on and so forth. Mm-hmm. And we did that last year. It worked out really well because it tailor the scheduling to the different people, because we had a lot of people with different workshops at the end of the year. We had Opal School, we had people with math investigations learning, so it worked out really well for flexibility. Our start time would be 8:30, our end time would be 3:20 for that.
So this may have a bus implication.
I already talked to the company.
Okay.
Option two, with the swap of 3 days, would be 45 minutes added to each day, which is an entire instructional block, 45 minutes. It would be 34 calendar school days for a total of 25.5 hours, which is just a smidgen over what we need, but it's a whole room. The last student day, again, would be June 15th. The last teacher day would be June 19th. Our start time then would be 8:25, and we would go till 3:30. Again, the busing issue is okay. I spoke to the busing company about it. All right. On the back side, I looked at swapping two teacher workshop days because I didn't know how the board would feel about next Tuesday being a change. So option three would actually make June 18th the last day instead of June 15th, which is what I had talked about on the other side. That's because I'm trying to keep it a 30-minute additional change. So it's 50 days, same thing. And then option four would keep the 15th as our last day,
But we would start earlier, instead of 35 days at 45 minutes, it would be 45 days, which makes it April 9th instead of April 23rd, if that makes sense. So if you look on the front where it says option two, we would start April 30th for 45 minutes, but if we only swap two teacher workshop days, we would actually start April 9th. Am I looking for one? Yeah, April 9th.
Oh, I see. We push on this.
Yeah, because it's just more days at 45 minutes. And those would be half days for students on the 15th and half days for a teacher on the 19th. So those are the four options I'm presenting. You could potentially look at other ones as well. That's just the proposed ideas. But I just wanted to go down to the considerations, yeah, things that we've thought about. Feedback from families. Do families want to look at this? Do they not want to look at extending days? I did talk to the bus company to make sure we could make it work with the bus company. We said absolutely, with either a 30-minute or a 45-minute adjustment, it would be no problem because we have three buses
designated. Dedicated
RGS. Paraprofessional salaries, I talked with Melinda. It affects two people on staff in terms of being paid accurately. Mm-hmm. So those two people, with one of them would actually come in later in the day, wouldn't make up the entire time. They would essentially miss morning meeting because they can't go over there a lot of time. Otherwise, they start either paying retirement for one or they go into overtime for another.
And obviously, because they're now going into a longer
time period. Right.
Yep, yeah, I got it.
So it affects two people, yeah, and we've got plans for those two people. We can't discuss those people in public, but that would be, there's a plan. Just mentioning teacher start time and teacher stop time. So if we end at 3:30, we have several staff members at children in childcare, and so I would propose that they make up their 15 minutes before, 15 minutes after in the morning. So they would just come 30 minutes before in the morning rather than doing 15 on both ends because they need to be home for childcare. Their contract says they do 15 minutes before and 15 minutes after with the kids. I'm just suggesting that for those that need to get to childcare, we would just say do it in the morning. I spoke with Marshwood today. Their projected last day is Monday, June 18th, half day. However, they're already talking about very informally, very in the infancy, they do late arrival or early dismissal. If they take off one of those, they don't have to do a half day on Monday potentially. So again, that is very preliminary, and I don't want to speak for Marshwood, but that's what the day they would give me for certain was Monday.
Right.
Aligning us with their release day makes a lot of sense for families because they have planned stuff already. This also helps with Camp Raleigh because they need to get in and get set up, and they are open to people outside of just Rollinsford, and so they need to start their camp when they need to start their camp. So that is a factor.
And they are planning on the 25th, but they will, yeah.
Right, correct.
Yeah. But they may not, yeah. Right. They have to wait and see what happens.
They have to wait and see. Summer building projects, the later we go, the harder it is for us to get everything in the summer done. And as you know, if we get the security grant, that's two more projects that were not anticipated or may not have been anticipated. Mm-hmm. So that matters. Another thing we talked about was providing meals for our students that receive free reduced lunch and 68 hours of hunger, and we would send enough to feed them for the 3 or 4 days, depending, just so that they would be able to eat breakfast and lunch. And then state waiver, so the information that I'm gathering about the state waiver is for schools that count days and we count hours.
Yeah.
So in New Hampshire, it's a minimum of
945
hours. We are basically at 9:46 at RGS because we have a very short day. So I'm not certain that they would, even if we applied for the waiver, give us the waiver based on that information. So other districts that have 180 days have 3 days essentially to give before they're even in an hour's conversation. We're already at the hour's conversation with no days to give. You could potentially do that, and if that's your direction, have at it. I just don't know where they would fall on that because we're already cutting it so close to what they consider the minimum. So I'm happy to field questions.
One comment is that I think it would be tricky to cancel the workshop on this coming Tuesday and communicate that, and you know, people may have plans already.
The families already.
Yeah. I mean, I actually, yeah, so that would maybe make it better to have the two workshops moved, but that's just one consideration.
Staff is for any option that's going to make it that we can optimize our learning time. I do think 30 minutes is easier for some of our staff for the child care issue. I think that's my thing. I think that's what the staff has said. It's pretty even. I mean, I've asked to send these out, revise them, and send them out again. And there was, you know, people are no one has said I can't do one or the other, or I'm not interested. They're definitely interested in one of the options, for sure. I think the hard part of the concern, I cannot believe I'm saying this, is that if we have another snow day, it really complicates things. For sure, it definitely pushes us out into that following week, which is tough. But understandably, that's just the way it goes. Personally, my opinion is a 45-minute block is better because it's an actual instructional block. And part of what we need to do is support the related art services that or related art classes that have been cut because of snow days or missed because of snow days. And 45 minutes is what they need to do that. By doing 30 minutes, we'd essentially have to do it like two different days rather than one. And just for me, I think that scheduling nightmare for everybody and quality instructional related arts time made up, this needs to be 45 minutes. But that's just my opinion. The staff, I said, the majority would prefer a 30-minute addition.
I've heard other schools, I've talked to some other parents, other schools that have gone with extending the day. I want to say Barrington. Some towns that I've talked to.
So my question is, how does all this work? I mean, obviously we have to meet legal standards to have a full school year. I hate to get to this part and not be able to do that. And so obviously we have to do what we have to do to fit it all in. And we also need to have a certain number of students in school to have it be a real school day, right? We can't just have like 10 students show up for it. Right. I mean, so we can't.
So we don't typically do the Saturdays.
Right, that's what I'm going to say. I mean, if we can't make a decision, for instance, to suddenly say, well, we'll cancel April vacation and then only have 50 kids show up. We can't just do that, I believe, right? That's what I'm trying to get a sense of, right? So, because it wouldn't count as a school day. So these all seem, and so essentially, my question, I guess, to Lori and to Kate is, I think we as a board will take your recommendation and work on this. I mean, as the two snow days came this week, it was like, oh dear God, we really have to do something. I don't know what is scheduled for the 20th, which is just next week, and if it's something that even can be rescheduled, but to Aaron's point, it's just a few days away.
Yeah.
So
the only thought I have about the 20th, Aaron, is that all other siblings are in school, so very few of our kids will actually, I looked at that to make sure it wasn't, I mean, I know she doesn't have full workshop days, but I also looked to make sure it was a normal day, that there wasn't other things. So all older siblings, whether they go to the middle school or the high school, will be in school that day, so it's not, I don't think too many, and there will be a few families, I'm sure, but I don't think it would be a huge portion of our, and actually for some families, it might be nice that they don't have to provide childcare. But yeah, I did think of the same thing. It is really short notice, and it wasn't, a week ago, that wasn't even on. I hadn't even proposed
right.
that, but after
that's
this week.
Not to bring it up, but that's the data predicting.
Yeah, I was
just
saying. But to be honest, actually, I hadn't even. I'm glad you even mentioned that next Tuesday is the day because I forgot.
We did have our math consultant coming on Tuesday. I already spoke with her. She'll be coming later in the year. It's not a problem to move the day, which is helpful. Actually, both our math consultants have been flexible around that because we've had quite a bit of.
I think adding the 45 minutes makes the most sense. I agree with Kate on that one. Just scheduling wise, it seems like it would be the easiest thing.
All right, so option four?
Yeah, or whatever.
Or two.
Two. Either one. I also kind of like the fact that it gives us like a contingency day to meet that Monday. Because
yeah.
That's when Marshwood currently will be going to. It's kind of. Case thing to have, right? Because, I mean, if we have another, if we push it to the 18th and we have another snow day, then we're, you know, bumping it out, it seems to make sense to me. But I don't know about the next Tuesday thing. I abstain from that part.
Another factor for us was, in terms of afternoon, was to not go past 3:30 because we know so many kids are involved in sports. So that's why we tried to add a little on in the morning and a little on in the afternoon rather than just tack it and make it 3:45 given how many of our kids are involved in extracurricular things. So that felt like a reasonable amount of time. It also then wouldn't cut into Funtown University's students very much. If we had gone until 4 o'clock or 3:45, there are a number of kids that may not have then gone to Funtime, and that was a concern for us as well. So we tried to be, like, find that middle road for families.
I think that the 2 days seems to make sense, even in terms of the school being able to have a little time to figure out what they're going to do with the extra time. I don't know. I mean, maybe you're all really able to do it very quickly, and maybe you can. Maybe you're already thinking about how to do that, but maybe that. So I'm leaning sort of toward the two workshop days being swapped out, and the 45 minutes is what I'm leaning to. But again, I want to hear from the experts and hear what you have to say, and what the parents have to, parents on the board want to say about it too. And how the rest of the board feels about it.
I think that adding 45 minutes makes the most sense. Which, these kids are flexible. You know, I'm not going to hear anything from Morgan. Oh, well, yeah, you're going. See ya.
I don't think they're going to even know.
They won't. Most they of them really won't. Yeah.
I mean, the older kids might be, but not really. I mean, I think that it's. Fight is a little bit on both ends. I don't think it feels terribly low.
It's going to be low in.
I agree. The impact is going to be a lot on the staff. It's where it's going to fall. Yeah. And so again, I mean, I'm willing to listen to what the experts have to say, whether
so 4 or 2 basically is where we're kind of leaning, right?
Yeah.
Those are the two.
If you did the 3 days and you end up with a snow day next week,
right.
Do you have to switch to the option 4 anyway?
We could either switch to option 4 or then extend ourselves out.
Well, I've been following the weather, everybody.
Oh, good, I was going to ask.
So.
I believe it's downgraded to like 1 to 3 inches, and we're coming in 1 to 3 inches.
Right, but you've got 3 days.
That's fine, it's 3 days. We live in New England, we can handle 1 to 3 inches every day to get here.
With a plow truck.
She sounds like
people up and bring.
We have one working plow truck in town, Cage.
All right,
I mean, I think you're right. Where you know the storm and may already be coming, you know, to me, option 4 makes the most sense. You know, Kate's described, you know, that instructional block. Half an hour, even though it's only 15 minutes difference, it really does make a difference. By the time you get started, a half an hour feels like you're just kind of tacking on time, whereas 45 minutes is like she described, an instructional block. So I mean, that would be my preference.
So you're saying option 4 in that sense?
Yes.
You're saying,
and then you have a plan. I mean, I don't have any wood to knock on, but I want to believe that if this next storm does come in the way that it does, I'd like to think that's going to be the last one. And then you've made this decision, and hopefully you won't have that, you know, some kind of crazy April 1st storm, you know, when your foot dropped on you, which we had a few years ago.
April 6th, 1981.
Yeah, so those things do happen, but hopefully that won't be the case. We've had our fill.
Is that the start date will depend upon what works but that we go with for the 45-minute walk, kind of that kind of motion. And it begs the question, I mean, in the past, there have been sidebar agreements with the union to have a longer school day every day, so that when these things happen, it doesn't, we have the leeway to do it. So that's something that the negotiating team coming up this year might want to think about too. And it's always good to keep these things in mind.
Okay. I make a motion that we move ahead with option 4.
I second.
Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Thank you.
Thank you for all the work going into this. This is, it's not easy as we get to this point. And
I will tell you, Lori is my guru. She sits with me through all of it.
Well, why don't you decide? You'll get this again. Thank you both for all that work. Under action items, our next action item is a bittersweet action item. We all received in our packet Kate's wonderful letter of resignation. And while it's bittersweet in the sense that, of course, we hate to see you go, Kate, but we are very pleased that you are going out to the broader world and taking your passion for education. And we're glad that you had your time here to instill that passion in the staff and the board and the community. And we really wish you well as you go forward. Thank you very much. It is our duty now. I will entertain a motion to accept her resignation.
I make a motion to resignation.
Second.
Okay.
Siri seconded it.
That means okay. I don't have to.
All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
If there's anyone else that would like to say, I know. I'm sure you feel privately. I'll do it publicly.
We wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
For your time.
Thank you.
You have to tell more.
Excuse me, we all need a moment now to gather ourselves back. Budget. The next thing is budget. Katie, is there anything you wanted to call to our attention?
Not in regards to this. I just wanted, I told Judy at the beginning of the meeting, now that everything is passed, yay. I'll be getting all the forms ready, so you guys will have some signatures to do. So I'm hoping to have them ready next week, so when you go to, I think there's going to be an SAU meeting, so you can do them all there. And then I'm also going to get the teacher contract all prettied up and ready to be signed by both parties, so that will be coming as well.
Yes, and what Katie and I realized is that it's been so many years since we had a collective bargaining agreement passed. We didn't know the work that we had to do to make it all happen and be, you know, in next year's budget and everything. So we're pleased to be doing that work. I don't know what it has work, but still, it's good to be doing this good work. I did have a couple of questions on the budget. And actually, I guess, so under the maintenance of grounds, the 2630 line, and I'm just looking at the summary right now. It looks like we're over by almost $19,000.
Yeah, because you encumbered all those additional
coolas
in there and the other things.
All right, I just wondered why it was.
So you see the savings under the SAU because that's where you said you were going to use that money from, but it has to be taken out of the correct line. So.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you. I had that.
Thank you. I said, wait a minute.
We were happy the other day and just decided to do a budget stop.
We our bottom line still looks very, very good, although it doesn't look like everything's been encumbered yet. It looks like I don't think we've spent hardly anything on special education transportation. There's a big chunk left there, which is nice, I guess. We'll see. And guess, well, I mean, a lot of this we won't know until the end, but some of it, the things sort of at the top are pretty close, I think. Okay. No questions on budget? We are now going to move on to the superintendent, I've had the superintendent search on my mind for half the year, so our principal search. Lori, you're going to walk us through the process. I can say that the ad was placed today.
It was. Mm-hmm. Or yesterday. I can't remember. It was,
no,
we
I did
we finished
it.
Okay, so we finished everything.
I've done it on ed jobs internally. Union Leader will have it Sunday and Monday, and Foster's will have it next Monday and Tuesday.
And it's on the website. It's on the website.
And then it's on the website.
So it's posted with a closing date of a Friday, March 30th, which isn't a huge window, but, you know, this is the time when everyone's looking. So, you know, I don't think it's a deterrent. Granted, if we hadn't had all the snow, it would have gone out earlier in the week. It's just, you know, it's been a crazy time. So so it is out there. I went over and talked with Kate, I've talked with Judy as well about the process that I see happening. So I would like to meet with the committee. I know Kate has had some conversations with staff already about interest in serving on the committee. And, you know, we'll talk about, you know, who or whom, you know, the number of folks from the board that want to be involved with that as well. I would like to meet with that group prior to the 30th, just to, you know, bring the group together, have a conversation about, again, the qualities that you're looking for. I know the staff has identified a number of things, but it's always good, you know, when you have a search like that, to bring everybody together so that everybody's on the same page, you know, in your community, parents, school involved. So I would like to do that. So once we know who the board member or members will be, then we can look to set that date. So I have identified in my calendar when I have time, but I'm not sure if it would be after school or an evening meeting. So we'll talk about that. So just to kind of walk you through the process. So Judy and I have talked about, you know, ideally if it all falls into place, that we would have a nomination for you for your May 10th meeting. So that's, you know, it's going to move along, but these processes need to. I mean, there are, I will tell you, having, you know, just looked to see what's out there for positions, there are a number of principal, assistant principal positions out there right now. So this is the time to be out there, and it's the time to, you know, if you find the right person, you want to make sure you capture that person. So what I would like to do is, again, meet with that committee prior to March 30th. That following week of April 2nd, to bring the group back together, bring the applications that we've received, and we can talk through all of those, look at those, make some decisions about who we would want to interview. You'll get a wide range, I'm sure, and you know, there, I'm sure, from the conversation we'll have about what certain qualities that you're looking for. So we'll look at them to see who you think is a good matches. The following week, I would see, you know, the interviews taking place. We have a school vacation in there, as you know. So April 16th to 20th, probably nothing would happen during that time because people will be away and such. The following week of April 23rd, you know, again, depending and assuming that you have a candidate that you want to keep moving through the process, that's when we would probably look at doing either having them come here and spending some time here. We may have, you know, if they're a current serving administrator, you may want to go to their school, you know, and see, you know, what their school is like. And then, you know, we would have the group would come back together again with and prep a recommendation to go to the, again, that May 10th board meeting. But that, in a nutshell, you know, would be how I would see the process moving forward.
So that's a pretty aggressive time frame, and one of the things I think we should discuss this evening is sort of giving some direction to Lori and sort of as a board, because we're going to be the final person, that we're going to be the final group that actually hires, is, I know I've been thinking, I don't want us to rush into hiring just a warm body. I think it's important for us to decide as a board whether or not we want to carry on Kate's work, and I know I do. I think the work she's done here is remarkable, and I think the ad was, there were some great keywords put in there to hopefully get some good candidates that'll come up, but if we don't have a good candidate, we have to have a contingency plan. And so I want Lori and other people thinking about a contingency plan, an interim if necessary, someone who can hold the line while the staff who has come so far and done such good work can sort of continue their good work. So, and how do people feel about, first of all, that you know, we don't want to just hire the best that the best that, we don't want to just hire the best that applies, we want to hire the best. So that's clear direction on that. That's important to us. We're hoping to get some really good qualified people, but if we don't, it's we'll have to move to Plan B. And I don't know how easy that is either. We'll cross that bridge.
Right. We'll cross the bridge, but I also will start that. Depending on how the pool. Conversation with probably the principals association. You know, are there existing principals that are, you know, that maybe you have somebody that's retired, that's, you know, recently retired, that is looking for a part-time position. You know, there's various conversations that you can have around that. So, you know, so looking at who's coming in the pool, maybe it may become more clear. Well, it will become more clear as we get closer to, you know, when the answer.
And I think with that said, I think if we have a few folks that would like to be on that, it'd be really important to have. One of the nice things is that you're also all parents, and so you can be playing both the parent role and the board role on the search committee. And I don't know, so what are we thinking of search committee makeup?
The list that Kate shared with me was a cross-section of, there were a few teachers, paraeducators, some wear multiple hats, some may also be parents. You have somebody that has a union involvement, so looking at trying to capture, you know, a cross-section of folks without having, you know, 15 people on a committee. Yeah. Because I don't think that you're well-served when you have big groups like that.
Well, as I recall, the school district that hired Kate, I believe they had a search committee of 20.
Yeah.
It was huge, but anyway, were yours just school people?
No, cross.
You did the cross section. Okay. And what did you? What was your suggestion for board members? I was thinking two.
I think that's right.
I was actually on the search committee that chose Kate.
You'd be ideal if you're willing to, if you have the time to do it.
I would love to do it. And I definitely remember that we had, I think there were two school board members, maybe two or three people from the school, and then I think there were three community members, one of which was a non-school board elected official. I want to say it was the makeup of it. That's what we should do now. I'm just for historical reference purposes. Mm-hmm. I believe that's what it was.
We did have a question on the Facebook page today, wondering if there would be any parents or other community members on the committee. So just putting that out there. It's tough with such tight deadlines, I think, to be able to figure out who that would be and how that would work.
And I think if more are, you know, certainly, you know, if more, you know, whatever it would be, but,
yeah, I mean, if you can have three, I would also do it.
Your other option, too, is,
much.
Sorry, can I interrupt?
Yeah.
The other option, too, is, like, I did a meet and greet with families. And it would have been, if had there been other finalists, it would have been open to them as well.
Oh, yes. Yes, it's not as if the community and families
cannot.
The community won't have a chance to have it.
You could set that up.
That's probably going to be part of it. But the search committee is to narrow it down.
Right.
And to bring forward then.
And then you can potentially open it to other families that would want to have input.
It'll become much more targeted at that point.
That makes sense.
So this is to narrow it down.
Okay.
No.
Yeah, and then.
Sounds like a proxy.
We could have a proxy between the three of us, that may be good.
And I actually think that's probably, if Tom's agreeable too, to have it be as the community connections folks, you're really connected with parents pretty well, and you can get input from parents as you're looking for things. But I think that's a good, I think you're a good cross-section representation, so among these three, they'll work it out and just keep them informed and keep us all informed as things go along.
With the, just to clarify a question, with the plan of the May school board meeting, would it be before the school board meeting you would interview the two or three candidates, 1, 2, 3, 4, 7, 5 candidates coming? Would you have an early school board meeting on that night to have interviews with the candidates?
This is very
so the whole board had an opportunity.
Yeah,
so that's, I mean, yeah. When I was hired here, the whole board had interviewed me.
But now remember, so the timing is to have, you said to bring a candidate forward on the 10th, so, which is very aggressive, especially with a vacation thrown in. So I think we're just going to have to see, because I think it will be important to have a parent community forum, and probably at that same time certainly have maybe do the board, maybe we do a special board meeting to have, I don't know. But I don't know.
I would agree. I think it's important
that time
to have that opportunity to have a conversation with them. That's kind of what we were involved with hiring now for the new Summersworth High School principal. I mean, that's what we brought, the final candidate in, an informal conversation with the board. It wasn't necessarily an interview, but it was just to get to know. Which in this case, if three of you are involved, then you'll probably get to know them pretty well. But I think it's a good conversation to have. Whatever, as that group meets, what are those process pieces that we want to make sure we put into place so that, this person is supported by the community as well. So.
And definitely supported by the board. I think, not to put too fine a point on it, but I think legally, person being hired is being hired by the superintendent of schools, correct?
I have to recommend.
You have to recommend.
Right, so it's my recommendation to you.
Yeah.
And then you make that.
But we do actually, so the whole board will want to, we will have a whole board formal or informal interview. We will do that, and that will be done in public. So with however many candidates are brought forward. But we've identified folks, and that's good. I will tell you already right now, I will not be available after the 9th, after the 8th of June. So we'll see where we stand at that point.
So do we want to have other community members involved? I remember once resumes started coming in, then the whole group found time just to go to the SAU office, read through the resumes, and then we all met together to discuss those that we felt it wasn't just school board members who heard the resume reading.
Oh, no, and this it's going to be the whole search committee. It's going to
right,
be
okay.
It's going to be teacher staff.
Okay.
So I guess parents
we identify those people.
Yeah, well, I think Lori, essentially I'm thinking you're the head of the search committee,
right.
In essence, right? So and Kate sort of put together the makeup of the
Some people had asked me on it, some people, so I sent Lori a list of people that had said something to me and said this is their position and, that kind of stuff. So it was clearly, as you develop that committee, you want to make sure it's not just all one stakeholder.
Right.
You want it to look at the variety of stakeholders.
Right.
But you have those all staff members that you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we need non-staff, non-board people as well, I think.
Yes, I think it would be good to have certainly a couple of parents. Involved. And I believe
solicit some names to get to the board. And again, I mean, it's, for those of you that were on the superintendent search, I mean, it's, the cast of 15 was way too many. It was just way too many to get. We also did not have any viable candidates that first time around.
Just two questions. If you have three board members on it, does it become a quorum? I think you probably only have two.
Oh, no.
Let's take it.
No. I'll buy it. It sounds like you've been through the
process. Guys were first.
So I don't know if that's the case, but I think it's something to consider. I think three might become a quorum, and I think you
don't have to post all the meetings.
Well, that's true. If Tom and I voted no, and those three voted yes, we would be licensing them.
And then the other thing I would say is that you're going to get big really quickly. Yeah. So yeah, when you think about parents, you might want one, not two or three, because you're going to end up with 14 before you know it.
Talk among yourselves, figure out who will be representing the board. Okay. All right? No more than two. No. Any other questions on the process as it stands right now? Sort of the time commitment, because it sounds like it's going to be, there could be some weeks where there could be a couple of meetings a week, right?
What we get, once we know what we have, then that will certainly help us, to further define.
True. Mm-hmm. True. Yeah. And you're going to do your own, like, first thing through saying, no, not the farmer from Maine who applies for something.
Yeah, so that person will happen.
Okay. All right. So we're all set with moving forward, more or less there. Okay. Community connections, again, fabulous job with mailers and things. I did not get on the list for any of the union mailers, but I know they went out, and I know that some folks are not very good, so that's good. So I didn't get to see them. I didn't get to see what they were going on.
One thing I was realizing that we haven't done yet, and I don't know if we feel comfortable not doing it, is the parent surveys that we've done the last couple of years.
Yeah, what do you think about that?
You're right, it's March.
I know. That's exactly what I said when I realized it. We obviously had plenty on our plates. Mm-hmm. I think that's why it didn't happen this year yet. But, I'm not sure, I feel like we looked at the information and we absorbed the information. I'm not sure how much informing of actions and policy and it did for us. So I don't want to do a survey just to do a survey. I don't want people to waste their time. I don't want to waste our time. If it's not something that we feel is going to help us make changes, implement things, then I don't see a need to do it. But I'm not sure whether that's true or not.
We'd be better served to wait till next year, where there's going to be a number of transitions and. I'm in agreement with what you're saying.
And give us time to think about what we want to do with those results. How we're going to actually put them in there.
Yeah.
I mean, unless there's questions that you could, even input from you that would benefit us in moving forward, but it may serve us better to wait until some we've gone through the transitions and then come up with questions that we might have at that point.
But we may also want to take those results and actually have a meeting where we invite parents to talk about some of those things, obviously not asking, you wrote this.
We don't know that.
Who wrote this?
But it's like a discussion.
I think last year was a heavy survey year. I know that Kate also did one here in the school. We did one here. We did one at Marshwood. It's a heavy survey year, and I think a lot of good results. I think a lot of good came out of that.
Sure.
But I agree that we don't want to do a survey just to do a survey.
Exactly. And I mean, unless we, if there's a reason to, I mean, perhaps we change the questions and make it something like, "What's important to you in a principal?" What,
Yeah, but we don't have time to do that.
Right, exactly.
We have time
this round doesn't work out, then we have plenty of time to do it.
Yeah.
You know. Yeah, and I'm also thinking next year might be a good time we could have a question about, you know, we're about to look at extending our contract with Marshfield, because it's in the contract that we'll finish our first number of years and we can extend it for so many years, and, you know, what are some things you'd like us to look at, or is there anything that you'd like us to look at, those kinds of things. So maybe it's good to do it this week. So.
Yep.
Sounds like we're
cool with that.
Okay with that? Anything else on that kind of stuff? Anything else on that? I guess, so the next thing is Marshfield contract items, and once again, Marshfield is going to have a shortfall in their article is in the paper, and I meant to bring it, but for those of you who haven't seen it, they're having a shortfall in their revenue because of state. The state is not giving them as much money because they've done states change things around. It's not as bad as it was this current year that we're in. And they're doing what they have to do. They're letting some teachers, they're letting a third grade teacher go, I think, in Elliott. And somebody, they're making some other changes. They're reducing staff to meet it. So that's just going to be sort of interesting to see what happens. But it didn't affect, well, it's this year's budget that's going to affect our next year's tuition, so we'll have to see what happens there. So that's that. The other thing I did not bring that I wanted to bring is there was a wonderful op-ed piece in the New York Times just yesterday that talked about how that all the studies done, all the work done on the best way to help schools, this education become better, to help schools become better. There is one key person who can make that happen, and that is the principal of the school. It's the principal of the school that affects how a school performs, how the students feel about school, how the staff feels about school, and it is most important that if we as a school district want to improve our schools, we have to make sure we hire the best. Personality, and it's the last paragraph has everything that I want to see in a principal. It has to be someone with energy and passion who really loves education. And it's just, it was an amazing article and just summed everything up perfectly. So, that's just my two cents on that piece, but I'm happy to share the op-ed piece with anyone. Yeah, it's David Brooks in the New York Times from yesterday.
Okay.
Fabulous. And Late Start was also in the paper the other day. They talked about that they're going to be, they're not sure what they're doing yet, right? Do you want to give any update on that?
Well, I don't know if you guys got a chance to read the MSAB 35, their board minutes from the February 28th meeting. But they did go over the excellent summary of what the committee has been doing over the last
2 years.
Yeah. 2 years. So I jotted down some of the statistics from their survey. They put out a survey. 406 Marshfield Middle School and High School parents responded, and that represented 501 students. 71% responded that they would like some kind of change. 53% would prefer a start time of 8 a.m. or earlier. 28.8 prefer an 8:30 start, and 27.5 prefer no change. So now they're looking at three options, basically. One, no change at all to the schedule. Two, an 8:30 start time. Three was a middle ground, kind of 7:50 a.m. start time. And their next steps are to put out a survey to elementary school parents and the high school teachers and students. They're really taking it slow and they're doing a great job looking at how everything will be trickle effects with everything. So I still don't see them rushing into anything. So if you guys do want to be in that board minutes, they really went through pros and cons of all these options.
Well, thank you for letting us know that. And they did a summary in the paper the other day. There was a summary of the two, sort of buried somewhere at the end of a Marshwood article. But that's good. So they're not thinking of changing their elementary school times, are they?
No, that was not.
But they might do a survey of elementary school parents.
Parents, just because of the effects of changing the middle school and high school.
Yeah.
And that would, and with the busing, I mean, I guess there's all kinds of stuff with the busing and so.
Yeah, because the end of the day comes, it's almost the same as the elementary school.
Right, and if older students are helping mind younger students, then that's always important.
Interesting. Thank you. All right. So we mentioned it a few times here. It has not yet been announced, but the plan is that there will be an SAU board meeting a week from today, the 22nd, at I believe 5:30 is the plan. We plan to be at 5:30 at the SAU office.
What time?
I think 5:30.
Did you say next Thursday?
I think that's what we're planning is 5:30. Is that a difficult time, Tom?
Yeah, what is it? 5:30.
It should not be a very long meeting. I think it should be very targeted.
Why 5:30?
I don't know why 5:30 is chosen.
What is the meeting?
I imagine attendance at that is a little rough. That's why I said that.
At the SAU
it's a
office?
It's a personnel decision to be made.
Okay.
There will be a non-public component.
Is that the SAU office?
Mm-hmm. And that should probably go out.
It will be it
tomorrow.
Should be out tomorrow.
Okay. So I wanted to give you a heads up. I meant to be sending you. I meant to send you guys email on that, but I forgot. So. And then other than that, our next meeting is April. It says April 21st. That can't possibly be right. No. I have a excuse me. I have a
right.
It's April 12th.
Yeah.
So I'm dyslexic. I should have read that correctly.
Well, I don't know what I did. Entering them in my phone, but mine have been all off.
So it's April 12th, and of course, town meeting is Saturday.
And we have
our last town meeting. We are no longer a town meeting town after this. After this town meeting, so bring me cakes. We'll celebrate one way or another, right? Might as well eat cake. All right. Any closing comments by visitors?
Oh, the play is April 6th and 7th.
So school dates for you guys: April 6th and 7th at 6 p.m. is Peter Pan, and April 10th is the classroom performances in music for Mrs. Nichols, Mrs. Fix, and Mrs. Spear.
By classroom performance, are they doing the day, you mean? Or
at night, April 10th at night at 6:30.
Oh, at night.
Yep, it's those classes that have had music this session, and so their performances are that evening.
Thank you. Thank you. Any other comments by visitors? Any closing comments by the board? Thank you all. I think this is a great board to serve with. I really enjoyed it last year. We lead into the next year as we lead into next year. Early morning, I will not be here for the June meeting. If we should be invited to the Summer's Worth graduation, I will not be here to do that. I know Tom, you did it last year as vice chair. I forgot to mention that when we were talking about it. So Tom's always doing
this. You will be wearing a robe.
We don't know that we're going to be invited this year. It's our last year that we have any students, and Summer's Worth has always been very gracious about.
I'll say that. It was high. UNH.
Oh, it's at UNH?
Yeah. And you end up shaking hands with every other student
everybody,
and handing
everybody
out the
comes.
Oh, you do?
All those people you recognize, all those people you know. And then what happened was, though, I'm standing, it was Don, me, and they would come down, and we would alternate handing off the diplomas. So finally, they got somebody over there.
That's terrible.
Congratulations.
There was that picture.
The real world.
A lot of proud parents.
It's a short commitment.
It's a hot day.
It's a short commitment for those of us who are just shaking hands and passing the line. Congratulations.
It's well.
I don't know, yeah,
it's June 15th at 6 o'clock.
Anyway, if indeed we get a plan, you can just discuss with Rory what to do.
Okay.
All right. Thank you all very much. We do have non-public, so we'll take a roll call. We'll open up.